Nice. Yeah. Where did you go? You went to a barbershop?
Who cut your hair for you? Oh.
All right. Good. We had to like do like first 5 seconds. No one talking to catch the room noise. And then you could use it to clear out the voice later on.
Okay.
But yeah, but by the way, we are recording right now.
Okay.
So I was to the barbershop. I just came from it.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Wait, you didn't... Oh, you didn't cut right here. Oh, that, no, it's your hair down.
Oh, my hair is down.
Yeah, your hair was down. Okay. Nice. Yeah, I mean, you literally... Because when you're at home, you just pull it back and put it. All right, we're ready. We're filming.
You want to... I'm learning also, so you want to bring the microphone about like a fist. You could adjust it here if you want, and you want to make it like to this side because it's catching your voice from here.
From that way.
Yeah.
Oh wow. Okay.
So.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I just came from the barbershop. I was like, I need to come to JT. We only have like about a few hours to speak.
Yeah.
And also I just noticed that it's my last day at New York City.
Yeah. Well, you need to stay up all night so we can hang out. I mean, I'm only going up only because my friend, she if I didn't follow through with this, she bought these tickets for this movie. It's in Harlem at Central Park.
Oh my God, Harlem?
Oh my God, I gotta go to Central Park.
Abdul is there, by the way, right now.
Yeah, Central Park?
Yeah. He want to go see Central Park before he leaves.
Oh, I mean, if he wants to come, he comes to the movie. Mo's supposed to go with me, but I don't know. Mo.
Why at Harlem, though? Does he live there?
No, that's just where the movie is at. And I'm going to have to leave. This is where we're going to see. Crush Groove is, you know, iconic.
Crush Groove.
Yes. Is there, you know, it's an iconic movie. One of a bucket list movie that every brown person should ever watch, especially in the black community. Everyone has watched Crush Groove.
When was it aired?
This probably was aired in like the 80s. It was some of the famous rappers like Run DMC, the Fat Boys, New Edition was on this, Curtis Blow, Sheila E. These are all like icons that's like been very big in the hip hop world. So,
wow.
Yeah, it was like in the 80s. I can actually look it up to find the actual date.
That's really cool.
Yeah, I've seen it years ago, but let me look. I'll look it up to make sure.
My mom, yesterday, I think, or last night, she texted me. She was like, when are you coming home? And I just booked the ticket last night. And I told her that I'm coming in on Saturday at 1:30 p.m. I'll be arriving at the airport. So she was happy and all of that. And about like a few hours later, my dad texts me on WhatsApp also, like asking when I'm coming. And I was like, didn't you guys like share the message or something? Like why? And then I realized that he doesn't know. Like my mom didn't tell him yet.
Yes.
So I told him and then he was happy about it. And then he said, oh, then you could, we will wait you. Cause he has like a lunch that he's inviting my cousins that Saturday. And they planned it like a week ago before knowing that I'm going to arrive. And he said, oh, we're gonna wait for you so you can have lunch with us.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
So your dad's excited.
My dad is very excited. And I can't wait to come back from a 13-hour flight and meet everybody. And be like, hey, how are you? This is good. I'm good. What was your major? My major is chemistry. Yeah, it was fun and all of that. And it's like, I don't know. Like my dad, I think he is excited. But at the same time, I'm not sure from where did he get the like idea that this is the this is what I want right now. As soon as I come back from the airport, I know I'm going a little dark here, like a little bit.
Yeah, but it's like I think
you know, like especially my mom, like it was. Let me also put things a bit clear. Back home, when there's like a gathering, especially if it's like men, the women cannot be in the same section.
Mm-hmm.
So technically, my mom and my sister, like my female family, will have to be waiting inside until this whole event is done. Okay. See what I mean? Like when I come there, I have to sit and I have to eat lunch and then I have to sit with them and converse and all of that, and my family are waiting inside.
Well, you can't, but during dinner you can't excuse yourself, act like you go to the restroom or something and go in and
see. Yeah, I could do that, but yeah. What the 10 minutes gonna do?
I mean, but at least you can see them. I guess you gotta look at it like this. That's also, I think also that's just you getting back used to your culture, because that's like, I do understand you should act. I mean, at this point, it's, it depends on what time your dad is going to have everyone come. You could ask him, could he have everyone come at 4 o'clock?
Oh, no, I can't do that. Because he was like.
So what did he mean?
Because I can't. I don't know if it's like this is him being genuine or like him is doing this personality, but the personality that he came at me with is the dad that is very excited and is almost gonna cry that I'm coming, and I can't really, you know, be like, oh, you know, could you do this, push it a little bit, could you do that, because he might be like, oh my god, I've been waiting for you all the time.
But that's not inconsiderate. Just say, did you ask him what time you're actually gonna eat?
He said, he didn't ask me back. When do you want it to be. He said, I told him I'm coming at 1:30. He said, okay, we will push the lens.
And how far, and how long are you from the airport? How far are you from the airport?
Yeah, I should have actually told him that they should carry on with the lunch and not wait for me.
Well, so I think you, this is, don't overthink things. I think you're. Be very open-minded about things, because regardless, if you get at the airport at 1:30, you got to go through customs to come back into the city. I mean, come back. You got to get your stuff. How far are you from the airport?
We live pretty close, like about like 30 minutes max.
So roughly at the earliest, you probably won't get home till 3 o'clock.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So if you say, hey, Dad, can it be at 3 so I can get a time to take a shower, unwrap, say hi to mom, and then at 4 o'clock, I'll come out, or you say you can start it at 1:30, and then at 4 o'clock, when I first come, I'm gonna go in the house. But
I should do that. Yeah, I should let him know that
when you're dead,
I'll come and see like the family and all these things, and then I'll come to them later. Cause,
I mean, it's not. I mean, if it's,
and they can understand too. Like, yeah, I guess definitely.
You just came here, and also, ideally, if everything goes, if the flight goes as scheduled. I mean, there's so many different variables, like. We've been having so much rain here. Who knows? I mean, you don't know anything about tomorrow. You know, it could be delayed. Is it a direct flight all the way through?
It's going to be a transit. So we go to the capital, Riyadh, straight from JFK to Riyadh, the capital. And then I'm going to lay over for about like 6 hours. No, it's going to arrive at 9. And then my next flight is at 12:30 p.m. So it's about
3 hours.
Yeah, three, 4 hours, something like that. And then I'll arrive at...
But how far is it, the capital drive from your family?
It's a 1 hour flight.
No, it's only a 1 hour flight, so it's like a 4 hour drive.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it took a... I also have that big box that you might see.
Okay. What, that wooden chair? The one chair you made? That's the one you're trying to take back home?
Uh-huh. Okay.
Uh-huh. I packed it. That wooden chair that I made is amazing. Okay. I can't leave it. I can't leave it.
I mean, it's definitely your American stamp of being here.
I put the picture of that big box. It's like about 1 meter cube now. Mm. Put a picture and we wrapped it with green... With the plastic that's actually kind of greenish, and put it in my Snapchat story, and my mom was like, "Is this the box that you're talking about? That we need to have like two cars to come and pick it up because it might take the whole space of one car.
Yes,
and my luggage need to be somewhere." And I was like, "Yeah, that was the one." And then I think they think there's a lot of little stuff in that box. And they might be surprised to see just like a one item.
Well, you probably did, but you have a picture of it. You should just take a picture and show your mother what it actually is.
I did not even show her the glasses that she asked me to buy for her, like the 5 glasses for my cousins, because I was like, I want you to see it by yourself. It's much better.
No, it is. I think that's more special.
Yeah.
Because you got them at the outlet, right?
Yes, yeah. I got them with the reason. Actually, she gave me about $770, something like that. Mm-hmm. And I managed to get 5 sunglasses. And she had like a $15 remaining.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The outlets are good. That's where in Michigan, I went to 2 outlets. So there's one in... Great Lakes, which is near Pontiac, Michigan, and then there's one in Birch Run, Michigan. So I went to 2. So I bought actually that bag I had. I went to the Coach Outlet. So yeah, yeah. There's 2 outlets. There's one in Jersey, and then there's one closer. Like if you're going, I don't know which one you went to. That's why I was gonna ask you.
I went to the one. I thought it was the New Jersey one, but it turns out to be New York Woodbury.
The Woodbury is not 2 hours away.
It is 2 hours then because it was traffic. Yeah. But when we came back, it was just like one hour and 7 minutes.
Yeah, the Woodbury is like an hour. Because that's when I was like, when you said 2 hours, I was like, you must be going to the one in Jersey then. Because the Woodbury Commons is on. But also, I didn't know what time they closed. But it all worked out.
Oh, yeah. We managed. Well, I'm glad that I at least managed to get the glasses for my mom. Because that was essentially the main thing I'm going with.
Yeah,
that was. And I happened to do that. I got her 2, so she told me, I'm going to give you this sum of money, and you need to give me 5 sunglasses about, like, guys kind of heavy, like hip stuff.
Yes.
And they must be brands, like high brands.
Very nice.
Like that. I was like, I'll try. So I got her 2 Armani, 1 Dior. Is it called Barberini or something?
Barberry.
It has an N in it. The end.
Bardoff?
Barberini. Something like that. And the other one was... Barberini, I think. I think it is Barberini. What was... So it was one of this... So two Armani, one Dior, one Barberini, and the Ray-Ban.
Oh, Ray-Ban. Okay.
Yeah. Cool. Got those. I think she's going to like them. Then I got my sister her purse that hopefully she's going to like the name tag that I...
I don't know why you... Listen, you worry about things, sweetie. She's going to love that. I mean, that was a great gesture. Okay.
I hope so. We got a suitcase. Now I'm shipping with me. 4 checked in luggage. 3 suitcases and 1 box.
Okay.
Yeah. Gonna do that today, by the way.
Well, you gotta go check your luggage in today?
No. Today at like 8 a.m. in the morning. Our apartment bell is ringing. I was like, who is this? No, nobody like come and ring our apartment. Like to the point where really I thought that was just the echo of the neighboring apartment bill. And I got out and I see Abdul, you know, was sleeping in the living room. So he already paced me to the front door, and he turned his back to the apartment, and I was like, who was the guy? Because he saw him from the eye, and he said it was a black dude with glasses on. And I was like, I don't know any black dude with glasses on. Mm-hmm. Definitely not you.
Yeah, I didn't see. Not at 8 o'clock in the morning, because yeah. I work.
So I was like, who? What? And we didn't mind. We got back. I woke up since then. And then when we got out of the apartment, when I went back to close the door, I noticed a paper had been taped to the side of the door. And I took it, and it's my landlord, mm-hmm. and it's saying that I need to, like, basically telling me that I need to pay the rent, and I haven't paid it, and blah, blah. But the interesting thing is that it was a stack of papers. I think it was about, like,
you know what?
8 pages.
You probably don't want to. Yeah, you don't record that one. Let's cut that part out. You don't want to. Yeah, cut that part. All right, okay. Go ahead. But you rang the doorbell. Someone was so real. All right, cut. We'll pick up from this. Someone rang the doorbell. You didn't know who it was, and then you went down. What happened?
I went down, and I just, it was the dude. Then he left.
Oh.
Yeah.
I know, that weird. That happens to me before too. Somebody might be looking for someone else's doorbell. I mean, someone else's place, and wrong place. Yeah, it happens. Especially to wake you up at 8 in the morning.
That's really true. It's crazy.
Yes. Yes.
So how does it feel, JT, that you live in New York?
I know. It's one of those bittersweet things for me, too. Like, just trying to figure out, do I just leave cold turkey, which means like leave without finding a job and just go, which I think probably would have to happen. I might just have to resign from my job one day and just say like, I'm leaving and just go. But I'm gonna have to. I mean, this is coming to an end for me. Because New York is just, it's so hard to leave. It's just like, it takes over you. It sucks you in, but it's like also, I'm just ready for a better quality of life. I'm like, I'm tired of seeing. It's, I mean, as beautiful as exciting it is, but it's just small things like having a backyard, like
having something for a long term.
Yes,
especially relationships.
Yes, too.
Like if like I'm leaving too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like from I bet from your perspective, this is like, if it was somewhere other than New York, I might not meet the Saudi person that would end up just staying here and leaving.
You know, it's so funny. When I went back home, it's like I've been gone for so long. So home is different to me now, too, because so much has changed because I've been gone so many years. So it's like, wow, a place where everyone else is like over it because they live there. And I've been gone. So when I come back, I look at where I live, like in a different perspective, like, wow, I got a different lens. I was like, oh, wow. I remember this, that. It's like so many new things. So I'm excited to explore. So that's one.
When you lived there, you were the younger you.
Yes.
Yeah. Like it's special, like physically, like you were shorter.
Yeah.
Things were bigger. Now you came back and you're like, what? I thought this street was way bigger than what it is. Like
the whole, yeah, you look at, it's so wild to look at things from a whole different lens. It's, I mean, it's been like 30 years since I lived there.
That's crazy. 30 years. And it's been about like 13 probably years since I lived in the village I grew up in. It's 13 years, and it is as much similar to yours in terms of like the physicality of like how short I was,
mm-hmm.
and how tall I am. And I see my friend is doing like snap that he's still there in the village, You're taking snaps, and I'm like, wait, that wall was not was that short. Because he's taller. Yeah. And like, you know, mentally you can imagine like how, you know, what would you look like when you go there and you see it, like, why is this sweet? Like for some reason, this whole neighborhood have shrunk.
Yeah.
And it's weird. And yeah.
And it's funny you say that because it's just like after living here, so much space and so many, and it's just like a place that's very familiar where you thought was so big years ago, how it seems so small. Like now, I remember growing up, driving 30 minutes across town seemed like it took forever. But now that's like nothing to me because I'm so used to the commute here. Mm-hmm. And actually, like even like living here at first, the commute, I was like, oh, what is going on? So
commute was crazy here at the beginning too with me. With all the traffic and the people coming in, and it's like the whole flow of people want to, like, some people push each other, and that's like, that's the etiquette. It's like, you just go on your day and you just try to do the minimum damage as you can. And you put your golf first, like before even the person beside you. And I'm like, that's really interesting. And then when I came to, like, I had this first, like, feeling coming from high school where we know our classmates, we build up friendship and all of that, and come to university here. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I'm trying to, oh, these are my classmates. Like, I'd like to see you. Like, we build a friendship and stuff like that. And then as soon as the class rings, all of them, like, scatter. I'm like, wait, what? What's going on here? And then it turns out it's not that every class that I have different classmates in it. And it's very difficult to make friends with your classmates because they're not the same. You meet with them, it's only like one class.
And especially when you don't live on campus anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. That's true.
Yeah. That's what made it. You know, I had that same experience. I only lived on my college campus for one semester. And after that, I lived off campus because it was cheaper to live off campus for me. Because what happens is, college tuition is based off if you live in state or out of state. So since I wasn't a resident of Ohio, the fees were more. So it's cheaper. So my father got me an apartment, and I lived in an apartment the whole time.
What are you planning to do when you come back? Are you planning to go to Detroit, right?
Yes. Or either Saginaw. I don't know yet. I don't know if I'm going to continue in education or reinvent myself, find something different to do. I don't know. I'm going to see what happens. Whatever calls me.
Is this question one of those questions like when you graduate from college, like, when are you going to get married? Or like, when are you going to get a job? Is that what's happening?
Oh my gosh, it's one of those questions. Because it's so funny. I told my dad I'm coming. He was like, why are you coming back here? And I was like, what do you mean why I'm coming back here? I haven't lived here in 30 years. Like, that's why I'm coming back. I want to live by my family. It's so funny. He'll be like,
you don't want me? Like,
what? I mean, literally, it's like, okay, I could see at this point, I mean, Dad, you're 76 years old. So, like, I mean, your time on this earth is not infinite. So it's like, I mean, but you have, I mean, you have to start thinking like things like that. I'm like, what do you mean? You don't want me? Like, okay. I mean, just be realistic.
Wow.
You know.
Oh, that was cool.
Yeah, you could have said that to me when you were, you know.
So if you were to get a car, what would it be?
What would I get right now? I don't know. I've been wanting a Jeep Wrangler too. I want a Jeep Wrangler. Either that or I like the little Coopers.
Coopers?
Yeah, the little Coopers.
Well, what are they?
They're like a Mini Cooper. They're like short. They're a little small. I don't know, for some reason I just want that little small car. I don't know. At least at least one of those. Nothing real big. I mean, there's not a, those not $1 million. Or I wouldn't mind a Tesla.
Oh, Tesla is nice.
I might get a Tesla.
That would be a smart choice.
Yeah. I might. I mean,
I think they're going to raise the gas price. prices, and they're gonna make the electricity way cheaper.
That too, and I think what's gonna happen is that at some point they're gonna ban gasoline cars.
Yeah, and you and I have lived in the era where there's gasoline cars.
I lived in the gasoline, and now we're in the hybrid. We went to the hybrid. Oh, they had, right. They had the, and then now they just have the electric. You're right. So you got this. I don't know. Would it be in my lifetime if they just say, okay, we're getting rid of all gasoline cars? They're going to make it harder and harder. They're going to make it more expensive. They're probably going to stop. They're going to stop selling them.
I've noticed they're going to make it expensive to own a car, period.
I think they're going
to... Like, you want you to rent and stuff, like Revel right now, the one with the bikes. They are making a new service where instead of renting a bike to go around the city, mm-hmm. on the go, mm-hmm. you could rent a whole car, an electric one, on the go.
I mean, everything is just...
Which isn't it scaring you a bit? Doesn't it scare you? Or like, you're like, whatever.
I don't know. I think I'm part of a generation. I've seen so much change. Like, I saw the beginning of so much new technology. So it's like, I'm cool with just charging my car versus stopping at a gas.
No, that's not what I meant. Yeah. I meant more of like, making it difficult for you to own a car.
Mm. No, I don't think it's gonna be. Honestly,
like people are not, like, why would I own a car where I could just, you know, use one, a new one every time on my app, and it's right where I want it, and I don't have to worry about parking or anything else. Same thing with taxis. Like, why would I go and like to the street and wait for a taxi where I could call someone to come to me?
It all depends on New York, that works. But like in the Michigan, you gotta have a car. There's no way to get around. There's no way to get around. And they wouldn't have enough cars that everyone could share. To get to work, you gotta have a car. Yeah, we don't have public transportation like that.
A lot of times when I think about the future, I always like have examples of New York, mm-hmm. and sometimes I forget that New York is just a city.
New York is, you know?
It's not like the whole world, like it's its own world. Yes, it's crazy.
Yes, other places are more like you're back home. Like if you don't have a car, you can't get anywhere.
No.
Yeah, it's just
like a 15-minute walk in the middle of it. You're like in the middle of highway. We're just like walking and like a car walking by, like who's that psycho that walking by himself?
Like literally, like someone thinking you are trying to do, your car broke down, they see you walking, or think you are like a drug addict or something. Like who's walking? No one's gonna walk on the highway.
When we went to the camping trip, we arrived at night because it was very late. Then it took us about 2 hours to get out of New York City. Like literally, it was during a storm. I think the storm that was in the tornado that was in Miami.
Oh yeah,
I think it came to New York.
It did. We did get a lot of the after effects of that.
So we ended up arriving at the camping site at, I think 11 p.m. I think, something like that. I remember I texted you like very late at night, and
it was like seven. How long was it? It was like 10.
It was supposed to be 4.5 hours. And it ended up being, well, we got out of the house, 2 p.m., I think? 2 p.m., and we arrived at 11. So that's like 9 hours.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it wasn't supposed to be like this. But well, granted, we stopped for 1 hour at Walmart.
Buying all supplies for the whole
thing. Yeah. We bought, like, We went and got chairs, and we used them. And my Abdul was like, "Oh, we could get chairs, and then we could return them later when we come back from the camping trip."
Not with all that mud and stuff out there.
It did happen.
Oh, y'all returned them?
Mm-hmm. They accepted it.
With the mud on them and everything?
There's no mud on it.
Oh,
there was no mud on
it. Oh, it didn't rain up.
It was no rain?
No, there was. There was. But we also bought like a little shell, like the plastic sheet.
Okay.
And we kind of hung it up, like above us. So where we sat, there was no rain coming on the chairs.
Okay.
Yeah.
that was smart. Okay. What was the most exciting thing about the camping trip? How was that? Did y'all go hiking?
We went hiking. It was more of a... It wasn't really hiking. It was considered hiking, but it was like kind of more structured. Like there are steps.
Okay.
You know, it's like you're climbing a it's not a ladder. What is it? You climb them.
I mean, no, you would say like steps, like stairs.
You climb stairs. Yeah, exactly. It's like climbing stairs. The site that we went to, I think it was Greenwick is called or something like that. The hike site had about 19 waterfalls.
Oh wow.
It's a one waterfall, right?
Mm-hmm.
But there are like 19 spots where there's mini waterfalls like coming down.
Okay.
It's the same one.
Okay.
So it was like it was fun.
I have that itinerary. I was like, I'm gonna have to do that trip.
You should.
It was planned out perfect. I was just...
It's really cool. There's one of the waterfalls, they called it the rainbow waterfall, because
mm-hmm.
during the sun you could mm-hmm. see like a rainbow coming out of it.
So I have a question. Cool. What will you miss most about New York?
Oh, thing being fast.
Fast. It's like
what we did right now.
Yeah.
Like you having a friend over, like doing business with them. I don't know what you're doing, and then like me coming in, like doing this podcast after I got a haircut and I went to Western Union and I went to Buffalo Chicken. I did all of that in one day, and it's still like sick. This is what I'm gonna miss, me being able to do all of these things.
You're right, I did do a lot today.
Like this will take like a whole week schedule of what probably we have done today.
I think that's one thing. It's multiple things. It's just like, wow, I didn't realize I triple booked. I had to tutor. My last session was from 4 to 4:30. They came in. I've been meaning to give Ramona, one of my college friends, her son, these clothes. Then you came, and then I forgot. I'm going to the movies.
So you're going to go now?
No, I need to text Mo to make sure he's coming. You know how Mo is.
Mo.
Let's call him. Listen, we'll get Mo on the phone.
Yeah, get him. Get him on the phone.
Let's see.
Mo.
Too bad he don't have an iPhone. Make sure.
He'd be mad if I like when he hears I got a haircut. He's like, why didn't you call?
Roscoe, you on the podcast, live and direct. Are you done? What do you mean? Are you starting or are you done? Like what?
I'm just starting.
Oh my god.
It's
gonna
be so long.
And then you have to. You gotta close the shop down or?
Yeah, where you at?
I'm at home.
Alright,
it's not
gonna take me long. Alright, I'll go. By the time you leave, you create a message.
Alright. Good, messing with Mo.
It sounds very exciting.
That doesn't sound promising. Yeah, I think. Well, that's cool. You've been here. Did the time go by fast? Or does it seem like you've been here forever? Like,
in a weird way, it's like both. Like, it feels like it went very fast, but at the same time, it's like, finally, I'm done. You know?
Yeah.
It wasn't just New York. Like, yes, I've stayed here in New York City, in New York State.
Mm-hmm.
But it was like the first 2.5 years was in Tarrytown. And that was a whole, like...
A whole nother experience. So, when you were in Tarrytown, she was like, okay, is this what's in New York? I mean, the city? Is that what is it?
I had a different impression about it. And I had a more negative one, like in terms of like, oh, I'm not gonna get fit. I'm not gonna fit in. It's like, oh, I'm among locals now. You know, like you used to scare me because you're a New Yorker. And like, oh, they're like Americans, they speak English, and this is their own language. They're gonna judge me or something. It's like, I don't know how to speak. Like back in my language school, we were in a dorm and we all also second language speakers.
Yes.
So we had something in common.
Yes.
Where I'm going to university, my classmates are not gonna be second language speakers, it's gonna be locals. And that was kind of like a bit of fear. Like, oh, oh my god. And then I came in here and then we realized like
everybody is like
yeah, so not everybody, not only that because of New York, that's true, but also even the actual local speakers are not that full of themselves in terms of like, oh, we speak English.
Yeah, not in other places, because
this was cool, like in a way, it was kind of the opposite. They're like kind of impressed that I speak different, like two languages, and they speak only one.
I think that whole narrative or that has shifted about like, hey, and it's so weird here. I was like, I can't believe I understand so many people because they speak so many different. Like, but even here in New York, like people in the Bronx, whether you're in Manhattan or Brooklyn, they all speak differently. So it's just like, even back home, even though you share like one common language, everyone has their own little...
It's like slangs and way of talking and, yeah.
Emphasizing or doing different things. But yes, I do need to head out to this Crush Groove. I want everyone to watch Crush Groove.
Yes, everyone watch Crush Groove.
Run DMC, the Fat Boys, New Editions.
Oh, please tell them about your account Instagram so they can follow you and.
Sure, I have a collective I do for brown people who are creatives, just like want to start their business. I give them a platform to talk about their business. So look forward to us, and also you can follow us at Noir Genius. That's NOIR. Ingenious, GENIUS. Once again, Noir Genius. Follow us. Look for our website pretty soon coming.
That's on Instagram, right?
That's on Instagram. And
I'll definitely post the link there too.
Yes. And look at some of our apparel. My personal Instagram is JTDZNoop. J as John, T as in Tom. D as in dog, Z as in zebra, N as in Nancy, U as in umbrella, P as in Paul, and E as in Edward. That's JTDZNoop. So check me out. See everyone soon. Don't forget to watch Crush Groove.
Day one. Thank you, everybody.